Okay, so thank you very much to give me for giving me this opportunity to tell you about how we identified strontium in the two neutron star merger event from 2017. And we've already seen from Stefan and heard from also Gabriel and Nina about well, the kilonova and this, so I will just go very fast through how the identification and the gravitational waves were detected. But you have seen this these bands, and then following the bananas after LIGO and Virgo made the detections and the satellites, and then following that the imaging were done to find the host galaxy and the event, as you can see right here. What I will focus on is the spectroscopic observations, particularly the ones made with Exura and the VLT in Chile. Now, I just want to also emphasize that this is something that is only possible because of the massive observational effort that was made. And what you see in this figure from Abbott et al. Is going from the gravitational waves down to gamma rays, X-rays, and all the way through to radio. How different observatories and telescopes and instruments have been pointed to the event and made observations as a function of time, as you have here on the x-axis. And you also see the various dots here, which represent the brightness of the event. And you can see the images made, where you again have these little lines indicating the kilonova. So much for the imaging and the detections, which we couldn't have done without. But I, as I said, will turn to the spectroscopy that we made. And here I just want to highlight the host galaxy, which is luckily close by. So it's around 40 megaparsecs or so. We see the event again, and by subtracting the two images, we clearly see the kilonova. Also, as a thank you for staying on, I have made a little bit of a neutron star merger trailer that I can show at the end if we have time, but for now I will skip it. So we have various epochs of spectra observed after the event, and what you see here is the first epoch made with X-Shooter on the Very Large Telescope, and this is taken about 1.5 days after the event. And you can see at this point, we have fitted a black body here in the dashed line to the observed spectrum in gray. And you can see at the back, black body is actually quite a good match. So this means that the gas at this point has been thermalized and that the radiation can be well described by a black body. And this also means that we have that local thermodynamic equilibrium is a fair approximation at least. Also by making the fit to the observed spectrum, we can actually infer the temperature, which is about 4,800 Kelvin. Now, two things stick out clearly, and those are these deviations from the black body curve, namely these absorption lines that you see here and here. In the very blue, just below 4,000 angstrom or 400 nanometers, you see here the flux versus wavelength, and you can see here down at the very cutoff of the sensitivity of X-Shooter that there's a lot of noise. So therefore, we have actually focused on this let's say slightly red absorption feature just around 8,000 angstrom. Now, in my everyday life, I work on a spectroscopy of metal poor stars, and this is actually one of the angles that we started out with to identify the absorption line. So what we normally need is, are the spectra. You've clearly seen that we have those. Then, in order to compute which kind of element could create this feature, would be that we need the atomic physics as input, so that we know about the wavelengths of the absorption features, the line strength, and so on. We also need a model to describe how the gas in a certain layer is behaving in the sense of temperature and pressure. And then we need a spectrum synthesis code to help us compute and solve the radiative transfer and compute how the absorption line would look like. And what we then would do, would we would start out with all the heavy elements, the ones that are typically produced in our process, and we would then synthesize the spectra. And you can see here observed for a metal poor star and black dots. And on top, we have our spectrum synthesis generated with models and atomic line information. Now, we generally assume, and this is what we did, we had three different ways of identifying strontium in the kilonova. We used two codes, one our own LTE code and a spectrum synthesis code called MOOC, which is generally used for synthesizing spectral lines in metal poor stars, and it assumes local thermodynamic equilibrium. Now we made the computation, so here you have the relative flux versus wavelength, and here we have computed a broad wavelength range, as you can see, absorption spectra for strontium, yttrium, and zirconium. And you see two strong absorption features sticking out just here around 4,000 angstrom or so. Now, it is such that in general, when we look at stars or some astrophysical objects, they have a tendency to move with respect to us. So they either move away from us or move towards us. And if they're moving towards us, we will see a blue shift of the lines. Whereas if they're moving away from us, we will see a red shift going towards the redder wavelengths. And it's also such that the gas can be either rotating or expanding, and this would cause such line broadening. So we will not see the perfect lines as we can synthesize them, but we will have to fold in that these are moving and we will have to correct for this. Now, what we did was then we started by modeling all the heavy elements, basically starting from arsenic all the way to uranium. And we have seen here from the kilonova spectrum that we need to identify a feature in the moving space of around 8,000 angstrom or so. So of course we now need to correct for the blue shift of the spectrum because the gas expanding and moving towards us. And then we just compute all the heavy elements. And this is what you see here in the left-hand plot, where you have in different colors all the various heavy elements. And you see that the only thing that clearly has a strong absorption feature, just around 8,000 angstrom, is strontium. None of the other ones come close to reproducing this strong absorption feature. And this is what we did together with Derek Watson and Ron Selsing in 2019. Now, it's also such that the gas is expanding, and as it is expanding, it's becoming optically thinner, which means that we can look deeper into the gas. And as this is happening, we are starting to expect to see certain profiles in this expanding cooling gas. And it is namely what we call a P-Cygni profile. So if we look at here, we have a gas here instead of the star, we could have our exploding event. And we are sitting here as an observer. Now, this part of the gas will be moving towards us on the left side, and on the right side, it will be moving away from us. When the conditions are exactly right and the right energies and so on, we can see that some of the photons will be absorbed, creating an absorption feature. And then following, another photon might be emitted, starting to create this emission. And then we also have a contribution from this part of actually moving away from us. But here the emission will come from continuum processes, and this will create this red part of the emission profile. And since it's moving away from us, we have to flip it. So this is why in the end, we get a profile where you in the blue part of the spectrum will have absorption followed by emission. And it is such that since we are looking at a gas where part of it moving toward us and part is moving away, we actually have right here a part that is, so to say, not really moving. And this is where, when we do the projection of the 3D problem onto 2D, that we will have the maximum of the emission coming from. And this is why we have right at the peak, actually the wavelength of the element at rest wavelengths. Now, of course, the thing is expanding and it's causing some sort of broadening. So it will not look as perfect as what we see here, but rather something that has a broadened absorption followed by emission. And now this is exactly what you're seeing, which is a figure that you have already seen. And when we try to model this with the TARDIS, Monte Carlo Radiative Transfer Code, which is typically used for modeling supernova spectra that are also expanding, we can actually get quite a nice reproduction of the spectra. Now in this code, we are assuming that the photon is propagating through the atmosphere or the gas and will have a certain probability of being absorbed. And this will depend on the density of the gas, the wavelength, the line strength, and so on. Also, the code assumes that the explosion is spherical and it is a homologous expansion, and there's a single photospheric velocity. Now, it also needs a temperature, and the temperature we can actually fit by fitting a black body without any absorption features. So that will set the temperature. And what you've seen here now is just move from epoch to epoch one to epoch two is that you start recognizing the Pisigny profile with an absorption feature blue shifted and the emission feature just around the central rest wavelength of strontium, and then it is redshifted slightly. And you can see as you go down how it changes with time from 1.5 days to 4.5 days. Now, as I mentioned, TARDIS also needs this density profile, and by fitting the strontium lines, we can actually reverse engineer and figure out how much mass there was. So by fitting the lines and using this power law, we can see that the power law with n to the minus 3 gives a very good fit, and that from the different epochs that you have just seen, that we will deduce masses of 5 times 10 to the minus 5 solar masses in the first epoch down to the fourth epoch of about 1.3 times 10 to the minus 5 solar masses. Now you can also see that we need to have an initial density, and here we need to scale this slightly between the different epochs, otherwise we will overproduce the strontium feature in the last epoch. But as with everything, we need to put in assumptions, and this is why we say that these strontium masses are only lower limits. And with this, I come to my conclusions. Thanks to the massive follow-up campaign, we now have very detailed broad-range electromagnetic spectra of the kilonova that we can analyze. We have analyzed and identified the absorption feature using three different independent methods, and it allowed us to find strontium. And this was also confirmed by the rest wavelength of the P-Cygni profile, namely identifying the strontium lines just redwards of one micron. And using this Monte Carlo radio transfer code, assuming a power law, we could put lower limits on the mass of strontium ejected, which actually corresponds to about 1% of the total mass. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Camilla, for the third scientific talk, also exciting from another perspective again. And Gianluca?
Yes, my compliments. Also, there is a question from Olivier. Why would we see only strontium line and not other nuclei in the A equal 80 region? Is there a reason from atomic properties or any other reason?
So yes, I mean, if we, I'll just go back. Sorry, here. So from the atomic point of view, of course, it has to fit with the right wavelength that we are correcting for the blue shift, and this fits perfectly here. But also from the atomic point of view, the opacities and the absorption coefficients of strontium are much larger than, for instance, some of the lanthanides. So we were making a comparison, looking, for instance, at neodymium and cerium. And with the conditions and the temperatures and everything that we see here, the opacity of strontium is still a factor of at least an order of magnitude larger than what we would get from lanthanides. And it's also earlier been suggested that, for instance, it could be gold or something like that, but the gold wavelengths do not match with what we see here at all. And also tellurium and cesium, I believe, were identified as possible candidates, but here the first excitation level does not fit. It will simply be much too much weak line for the tellurium part, and for cesium you will end up being ionized instead of having neutral cesium, which was proposed in others.
Okay.
So yes.
So another question you had, Camilla, from Andreas Kohn. What about the other Pisigni profiles in the later spectra?
Sorry, I'm not fully sure I follow exactly what you mean. So you're referring to these epochs, or?
Yes, I see. Yes. I see more features that could be Pisigny profiles.
Further towards the red, you mean?
Yeah. For example. Yeah.
Yeah. So there were a lot of regions there that we had to cut out. So right now you see the cleaned spectrum. In this case. You see further up here where there are bumps and such, but the gray regions here we had to cut out simply because there was a lot of noise, there was a lot of contamination, a lot of tellurics and so on. So it would basically, as you can see here, be eating off part of what could have been modeled here. So these were really sort of cut out because of that.
how much broadening in kilometer per second one needs to recover the very broad strontium second observed in this kilonova?
So here the expansion is basically setting the broadening, and since it was expanding with about 0.2 C, that also goes towards the broadening of the feature. So it's really broad.
Okay, thank you.
Right. Thank you again, Camilla, for this exciting talk.